another buzz moment of manliness. Ah, shit.
Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7, The Buzz, KQBC, Seattle.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
3, 2, 1, go!
Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, it is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. Tonight we have a couple of the actors from the Blair Witch 2 project, which is coming out this Friday. But I'll not introduce them just yet because they're not here just yet. So when they do arrive, we'll introduce them and talk to them. Drew, you're feverishly working away at what?
Nothing.
That's right. Oh, that's going to be the title of your next book.
I thought of something for you today. I actually wanted to talk about it off the air.
Here's going
to
be the title of your next book. Deadline for Nothing.
Yeah, in a hurry for
nothing. You've been lying on your deathbed looking at your whole life through one big sprint through a parking lot, one big traffic jam where you're pounding on the wheel, something where you're feverishly writing away on some word processor before the clock strikes 10 o'clock, and all be for nothing.
In a hurry to go nowhere. But I thought of you today.
Beautiful.
I was running. there's a riverbed in Pasadena called the Arroyo, right?
Yeah.
And it's kind of a hangout for homeless people, and I came upon a few homeless homes. And they sort of hang out in these sort of bushes and trees and things.
Yeah, they make like cardboard shacks and stuff.
Yeah, and I believe I came upon the...
Family member?
No, the genesis, the source from whence comes the coil pot.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Really?
Yeah.
What do you mean the coil? You mean pot?
I don't think it was made out of clay originally.
Oh, really? You found a crapple pot? You found a coil pot that was made... Oh, you found some soft swirl.
No, no, no.
Well, here's what I'm saying.
No.
Drew, you're jogging in a riverbed.
Yeah. And I had to climb down some walls, and in these wall sort of areas, these protected areas where people lived.
Right.
And clearly I came upon a place where they...
And so there's some homeless people, and they don't have a bathroom or a sink like I have at home, so they have nowhere to do their business.
This is what I came
Drew on. Is drawing...
With the border starting to come up over here. With
really?
The, oh, yes.
Drew just drew like a crap-filled Cinnabon.
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly... Or, I mean, carefully, I mean...
Or the thing Mr. Wizard would fall into when he went into the Wayback Machine.
Tudor Turtle.
Tudor Turtle, yeah. Sorry. So you found a crap pinch pot.
And carefully formed.
Next time I bring it in, I'll fire it in my kiln. I keep a kiln in my glove box in my car.
It had been sun-fired.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's what the early settlers had to eat out of.
Yeah.
Crap pots.
Yeah.
And how did you know what it was made out of, Drew? Did you examine it?
At first, I thought this is a strange-looking coil pot.
And then upon further inspection, you saw some niblets in there.
It was very clear to me what it was.
And recognized.
Yeah,
What you don't know is I'd been jogging in the very same ravine not hours earlier, Drew.
It's strange how I thought of you immediately. I thought of your propensity for ceramics, and then I thought of all the things you do with stool and have
Thank
done
you.
In your life.
Thank you.
And I thought, boy, this is for you. I got to tell you this story. Remember the other night I was sitting here going, what did I want to tell you? What did I want to tell you?
I'll tell you
that
what. I would die a happy man if every time someone saw some stool, they would think of me. Whether some dog stool in the park or whether they just finished their business and turned around to admire their handiwork. If they saw me, a ghostly-like figure of me floating in their toilet like a slick above their stool, I would die a happy man.
Does everyone have to experience that? Because I do experience that. I want you to know.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One down and 275 million to go.
Okay.
So, now, what have we learned? Whenever someone sees either number one or number two, I want them to think of me. Thank you. Beth?
Hello?
You're 20. What's up?
Hey, what's up? How's it going?
Good.
Good.
I'm the patron saint of stool.
Patron saint of stool?
Stool effigy.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, if it'd been shaped like the Virgin Mary, you could have got half of Mexico down there to look at it. What's going on there, Beth?
Well, actually, before I get into my question, I have something question for you, Adam. Have you heard of the show IVTV?
No.
Show IVTV?
I don't think so.
What is it?
No. Well, it's a show in Isla Vista. My friends
Well, I do monitor most of the local college cable stations. I'm surprised I haven't. Surprised I haven't come across the Isla Vista public access station.
I heard you talk about Isla Vista a couple times on your show.
He talked about being mobbed in a van in Isla Vista.
I got mobbed in a van in Isla Vista, and when I was younger, I'd say about 21, I rode a motorcycle from L.A. in a rainstorm to Isla Vista. It never stopped raining. Isla Vista is about 15 miles further than Santa Barbara, and I wet myself while going 75 on my motorcycle on the 101 freeway, about Oxnard.
Why not?
Why not? Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. I was dying. I was drenched. The marrow of my bone was wet. I mean, hold on a second. You ride a motorcycle. First off, you ride a motorcycle 65, 70 miles an hour on the freeway, and it's raining hard. It hurts.
Yeah.
The rain hurts you.
Sure.
And so you go faster. So you're soaked through. Well, you want to get to your destination, but you're soaked through to the bone, and it's at night, and the leather jacket you're wearing, the shoes and socks, I mean, 20 miles ago you were soaked through to the bone. You got to take a leak. You're freezing your ass off. What are you going to do? This close to number two.
Well, I hope you didn't lose any game because of it. You might have smelled a little bit like urine, no?
Yeah, I always smell a little bit like urine, so
really?
It didn't.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yikes.
No, I showed up my friend Carl DeLutri's place over there in Isla Vista. I immediately jumped in his tub and just ran hot water on myself for an hour. I thought I was going to crack. It's horrible. All right, Beth.
Well, I think you should check your mailbox, perhaps.
All right, what do you want?
Your mailbox?
What do you want, goofball?
Take my advice.
Hey, what do you want?
Okay, my question. I've been going out with my boyfriend now for a few months, and just something that's just mind-boggled me. I don't understand. I'm blowing him, right? You know, and I'm enjoying it probably just as much as he is. And every single time, he refuses to come in my mouth. I don't understand it. He doesn't even understand it. We've talked about it. Speculated a little bit as to why.
What was the speculation
and
about?
And I thought maybe you'd have some insight.
What was the speculation?
What did he say?
Yeah.
There's a couple answers. Which one was it? Oh.
Hey, Beth, hold on a second. Okay. When you enter the city of Isla Vista,
yes.
Do they hold you down, shove a bong in your mouth, and force you to smoke like that scene where they forced Roddy McDowell to watch those horrible movies in Clockwork Orange? Is everyone in Isla Vista baked?
No.
Is that Malcolm McDowell?
I'd have to say everyone in Isla Vista.
Let me tell you something about Anderson. I said Roddy McDowell. I see Anderson starting to slide over to the microphone, and I yell, Roddy McDowell, Roddy! Sorry
Malcolm,
about it.
Malcolm, Malcolm.
I mean, Malcolm, sorry about it.
It's film, man.
Oh, kidding.
The other thing, you're aware there is Santa Barbara Community College.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Do you go to Santa Barbara Community College?
Babes.
Huh?
No,
yes, you do.
Oh, no, I don't.
Where do you go? You don't even go. What do you do?
I'm a anthropology major.
Right.
CSB.
Right. Yeah. You work at a hydroponics farm at the junior college. I don't know why he doesn't like this. What does he say?
He says that perhaps I will gain power or control over him by swallowing his chi.
Oh, please. Oh, my God.
Where does the chi go?
The chi on his gut.
I see. I see. All right. So he's just as baked as you are.
So you guys are not having sex?
No. I don't smoke pot.
Really?
No.
She has no excuse. You're not having sex with him then, right?
Oh, no. We have sex.
Maybe he just prefers that?
Yeah, but he doesn't want it to go in her mouth. I don't know. Maybe he respects you or something. He doesn't want to make out with you when he's... Wait, hold on a second. Hey, Beth?
Oh, that was the other thing. He thought maybe it's disrespectful.
Well, there you go. Does he get going with his hand to sort of milk himself when he's done with you?
I do the work for him, yeah.
You do the work for him.
He's like in a coma, you know, by that point.
He doesn't want to take over.
No.
All right.
But he will go, you know, grab my ears or something to yank me off of him when it's time for him to come, you know, because he just won't have it.
Then he wants to have sex immediately?
No.
He's done.
That's weird.
He's done.
That's weird.
All right.
So he's not gay or anything?
No. My God.
All right, you're fine, Beth. Listen, you're dodging a bullet, babe. I don't know what you're complaining about. You understand? I know. You see, listen, men are about the bottom line, whereas women have to read something into everything. You women, It'll kill you. You read something into everything. The guy wants the orgasm in your mouth. Oh, we got to sit down and talk about that. The guy doesn't want to do it. Even worse.
Yeah.
Which is it, ladies? Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And here's guys are pragmatic, which is if the girl doesn't want to do something that we don't really want to do either.
That's good.
Fantastic.
Good.
That's when you got the life by the nuts. Emily?
Yeah.
You're 15. What's up?
I have two questions. First of all, I've been listening to this show since I was like 10. So I'm going to tell you guys you're awesome.
Thank you. I'm sure it's a good thing, though. Yeah.
My first question is kind of for Dr. Drew.
Right.
And that is that I was wondering, I'm on the pill, and I haven't been having very good orgasms as of lately, and I was wondering if that could be because of the pill.
Is that the only medication you're taking?
No.
What are the medicines you're taking?
No, that's the only medication I'm taking.
And how long have you been on it?
About a month.
And what pill is it?
It's ortho tricycline, but I'm getting it changed anyway.
Good. That's a good. That the first thing you would do is try a different pill. But tricyclic pills usually don't do this, but they can.
Yeah. Hey, you see what happens when you listen to the show from age 10 on. You're on your third pill. You're not orgasming as consistently as you were when you were 12 and 13.
No.
Well, what's going on? You have a boyfriend?
Yeah.
How old is he?
He's my age.
Oh, good.
Really?
See?
Yeah, he is.
Okay.
The only one I've had that's my age.
You have, like, hippie parents or weird parents? What's up?
No, they're kind of tree-hugging hippies. They smoke weed, but, like...
They're hippies.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got the hippie parent thing because...
They're too strict to be hippie parents.
Huh.
Yeah, well, but you just said they were hippies.
Well, they kind of are. I mean, they smoke weed plenty.
Right.
But, yeah.
All right. Who's you think your dad likes his pipe better or you?
Definitely his pipe.
Oh, yeah, that's nice.
You'll find daddy somewhere else.
But I have another question.
Yeah.
Having it with my family.
Mm-hmm.
I think my little brother, he's 4. I think he might have been sexually abused. I have a little sister who's like a year old, and I really don't want it to happen to her. So I don't know what I should do.
Did you get sexually abused?
I don't know.
Who do you think may have sexually abused your brother?
I have no idea.
Why did it make you think that he'd been abused?
Because he, like, sits in his room, like, for half the day and, like, humps his stuffed animals.
Well, that's perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Really?
No, he doesn't sit there half the day.
Yes, he does. I swear to God. We have to, like, pull him off his animals.
Well, why don't you just turn the hose on him? Is he 4 years old?
Yeah, he is.
What's your household like?
Huh?
What goes on in your house?
Close your eyes, Drew.
Yeah.
I picture a VW bus up on blocks in the living room.
No.
Is it a lot of aggression in the house?
My mom is an alcoholic.
Yeah. Oh, baby. Hey, just for fun, what characters is your brother humping? What's a stuffed animal?
A giant monkey.
See, funny.
Kind of funny.
Funny. Thomas the Tank Engine, is he in there?
No.
James,
but he has
not Thomas.
Videos.
Oh, James the Tank Engine? What happened to Thomas the Tank Engine?
Well, James is one of his friends.
Oh, I see. What about, like, Buzz Lightyear or something like that?
No, he likes Buzz Lightyear, but he doesn't hump him.
Oh, he has too much respect for him.
Yes.
But he gives him a handy.
Yeah.
All right, baby. This whole thing's a mess.
Yeah.
Well, your parents are still together, though, right?
This isn't my, like, real dad.
Yeah.
But he's been with me since I was, like, 2, so I
kind of... Oh, baby.
Oh, boy. Well, listen, the 4-year-old, if he had been sexually abused, the younger child would be potential sort of victim for him.
I know, and I don't, like, want anything to happen to her because I really like her.
Why don't you bring it up to your parents?
What?
Well, what parents?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, okay.
Is your mom sober? Your mom can't get sober, right?
She's trying, like...
All right. Why don't you go to Al-Anon?
Yeah.
Or Alateen and see what happens?
Well, I'm in therapy right now, too.
Well,
go to Alateen.
Okay. And talk to your therapist about this. She may have a way to bring social services in.
Yeah, all right, Emily?
Yeah.
Talk to your therapist.
Okay.
All right, baby.
Thank you.
Take care of the show.
Bye.
Okay, if you're listening to the show when you're 20, I want you to come over here and shoot me, all right?
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Oh, boy. A lot of great parenting going on in this country. Rodney?
Hey.
Hey.
How you guys doing?
You're 18.
Yeah, first I'd just like to say to Adam and Dr. Drew, what's up?
Let me try. What's up?
What's up?
Oh, wait, let me try. Howdy? How's that go? All right, Rodney. What do you want?
What up, sucker?
I'm not Rodney, dude. I'm Bob. You hung up on me like a couple days ago.
Oh, we did?
Yeah.
All right. Well, now you're 2 for 2. Didn't it say Rodney on the thing?
It says Rodney. Can you check out what that is?
Jennifer?
Yeah?
You're 21.
Yeah, I am.
What's up?
Well, since I was 17 years old, I haven't been having a regular period. And, I mean, it became more regular about the time I graduated from high school. However, like, last summer, I gained a whole bunch of weight. Then I stopped getting it again. Then I lost all the weight that I had gained.
How much weight are we talking about?
40 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
So, and now I'm just wondering if this would have anything to do with that.
Your period?
Mm.
How thin were you when you lost all your weight?
I'm medium build. I'm about 145. I'm 5'7".
So you went up to 180, now you're 140.
Yep.
Basically. The weight loss could cause your periods to change. How often do you have your periods?
Well, I've had it twice this year.
Yeah, see, that's something else. Are you on any medication?
I was on some medication to help me lose the weight. I was taking Adipex for about a month or two.
That's not good.
Why? What is that, speed?
Speed, yeah.
Yeah, I'm into downers, right?
Right.
That speed?
Right.
That's not my thing.
No.
I'm into bennies.
Somebody...
Are those downers?
Yeah, it's the cross tops you're not into.
Yeah, I'm not into cross tops, I'm into bennies. All right. So what should she do? Tell her what to do.
Black beauties.
Yeah. No, wait, that's speed, the black beauties.
Oh, that's right.
I'm into bennies.
Jennifer, have you had an evaluation to see what this is all about?
Yeah, and they did a whole bunch of tests on me. They found out it wasn't my thyroid. They found out it wasn't, like, ovarian cancer, ovarian cyst. They found out it wasn't anything like that.
Okay.
They said that, you know, if I wanted to go through an invasive procedure, that they could test me for endometriosis.
Right.
But, like I said, I haven't had it really normally since I was 17 years old. Right.
It may just be you.
At most, I've had it maybe 8 times a year.
Okay, so there's something called hypothalamic pituitary axis dysfunction, which means that you're... Your cycling mechanisms just aren't regular, that's all. And all kinds of things can set them off even further. Anxiety, diet changes, activity changes, so medication certainly. So it may just be part of what's going on with you this year. And God knows what it was that caused the weight to go up so fast and then crashing down.
Hey, speaking of crashing down, when I was on the plane today, coming back, I was in Vegas for a day this weekend. I ran into a doctor friend of yours from SC. A guy, he looked sort of mulatto. Well, you think he was black. Older. So, well, I guess he went to school with you, but he seemed a couple years older. Hand specialist. Oh, man. He gave me his card.
Well, go get it.
Well, it's at home.
Oh, great.
He said to say hi.
Oh, thanks.
You know, so I told him, hey, take a look at my hand. My hand's been hurting me a little bit. And listen, anybody, and I thought to myself, if I was to impersonate, here's how you impersonate a doctor. You go ahead and inflict pain on strangers.
Right away.
You know, like, I held my hand open, and really, what's going on with my hand is I had this surgery a year ago, and it's got a dead spot in the middle of it where the surgery was. It's numb. I can feel it. It feels like it's asleep, right in a little spot right in the middle, which doesn't hurt, but it's eerie feeling. Doesn't feel right.
Right.
And also there is some pain. There's a little bit of pain in my fingers and that kind of stuff.
Well,
years of inflicting trauma upon my hand. So he thumped my hand. I held my hand. He held his finger up like he was going to tune a piano or something. Yeah. Like, doing.
No, right here. I'll show you where.
No.
Right here.
No, don't show me where.
Right here. Right.
Well, he doinked me a couple of places. Yeah. I was like, okay, hey, Pops, I'm gonna hit these. Slap you this bag of mixed nuts. So anyway, he said to say, I'll bring his card in.
Right.
Another thing that was funny is I was just goofing around, but I was on the plane and I called the stewardess over and I said, I was in first class.
On Southwest?
No, on America West, which is always an hour late, at least. And I said, hey, I got these, they give you this, like, Fiesta variety mix, which is basically airline for we can't afford nuts.
No, we're too much pussies to put nuts out.
Well,
somebody might be allergic.
No, but they could have given you the best part, which was the almonds, the smoked almonds.
Yeah.
So they have, like, that and the cheddar chips and the rice whatever and the popcorn, you know, all this junk's in a big mix. You got to sift out and pull the... pull the almonds out of there. So I said to the steward, I called the steward over. I said, pardon me, I'm used to eating nuts on the airline. Could you get somebody to pick all the nuts out of this and bring it back to me, please? And she said, well, like who? And I said, well, what's the navigator do when we're on the ground? I mean, obviously, he's not working when we're on the ground, and certainly he can find his way back to L.A. I mean, it's just Vegas, for crying out loud. So she said, well, what if the first officer did it? And I said, whoever. I'm hungry. I don't want to pick the nuts out of the mix myself. So the captain of the plane comes on by, and he walks back, and he said, yeah, is there a problem? And I said, yes. And we're just kind of goofing around. I said, yes, there's not. I just kept going as far as I could go. And I said,
God.
Appears to be that there's some almonds mixed in with the rest of this mix. I'm not accustomed to picking them out myself, and I don't ask that you do it, but that somebody take care of this for me. And he said, well, I'll be more than glad to do it. And he opened the thing up. He spread the thing out. The plane wasn't in the air. We were just sitting on the ground. He was playing along. I'm sorry, sir. And he picked them out. There was three of them in there. And here you go. And he gave me on a napkin. And I said, okay, this is not going to hold me very long, so could you keep a few going? Not during takeoff, obviously. Let's get off the ground. But then when you put it on autopilot, see if you can give them a few packs up there, let them sift through and sort them out and bring them back to me later. Well, he didn't go that far with it.
No.
But he did actually do the sorting at the beginning.
That
so
is nuts.
I have to give him credit for that.
I know you want these nuts.
John?
Oh, hi.
What's up?
I went to bed every night, and I masturbate, like, a couple times a week. Every time I masturbate, I don't really wet the bed.
Yeah.
Are you sure?
I may not wet the bed every time I don't masturbate. I don't know.
I was going to say, you sure it's not a wet dream? Or maybe you're not peeing.
Oh, yeah, I know.
That's interesting. You don't pee on the night you masturbate.
I have no idea. I think that's a psychological thing.
And I also, like, I kind of piss when I come to it, kind of like that every now and then.
Okay, hold on. John.
Yeah?
I'm told you can't just say pee. Can we say pee?
Okay, I'll say pee.
Yeah, okay.
Have you had the pee, nighttime pee thing treated?
Well, I've had like DDAVP, pee,
right.
But that uses that.
What is that?
That's a medicine to prevent you from producing your own.
Okay, listen to me, everybody.
So you snort in your nose, the liquid.
Really?
Yeah.
Get some of that for car trips, right? Hey, but if you drink it, you just pee 2 ounces more, right? Hey, John?
Uh-huh.
Listen to me. I know you'll not do this, but please do it. It worked for me. I used to wet the bed. My grandpa, he got me out of this. He used to wake me up in the middle of the night, and I'd whiz in a bucket that was right next to the bed. And I never wet the bed when I slept over at his house. And it makes sense. I mean, just everyone, do the math. You wet the bed every night, right? You go to bed at 10:30 or 11. You don't wet the bed a half hour after you go to bed. You don't wet it probably before midnight. You wet the bed at a certain time, probably about the same time each night. I'm guessing if you go to bed at 11 or midnight, you probably wet the bed at 3, 4 in the morning and your alarm is set for 7:30 or 8. Okay, so you set your alarm. You don't have to set your alarm. You get one of them little egg timers. That's what I nap with. They're not shaped like an egg. They're one of those little kitchen timers. $10. You get them at any store like a Save-On or Thrifties or something like that. You just press in a couple hours. Figure out the rhythm of your bladder. If you wet the bed 3 hours after you go to bed, set this little alarm for 3 hours. Tick, 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 3 hours. Punch it, go to bed. Then it goes off in 3 hours. All you do is get up, take a leak, and get back in bed. You make it through the night. Why do we have to take drugs? Why do we need therapy? Why do we have to electrify the sheets? Just wake the guy up in the middle of the night and take a leak. He doesn't wet the bed during the day, does he?
Speaking of taking a pee.
Okay.
I gotta go.
All right. Why am I the only one who brings this up? I wet the bed fairly consistently, but my grandpa would wake me up at 1:30, 2 in the morning, go to bed at 10 o'clock. He'd tell me to whiz in a bucket. I'd whiz in a bucket, and I'd go back to bed. I'd never wet the bed.
He got you out of bed, too. I think you would actually need somebody to make sure. The timer may not be enough for some people.
Well, you obviously have to train yourself so that when that noise means it's time to get up and take one. But I bet you got one to give. That's why you're wet in your bed.
Agreed.
All right. We'll be back.
Back in a minute.
Yo, You're listening to Loveline on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
Hey, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Erica Leerhsen and Stephen Barker-Turner are both here tonight from the Blair Witch Project 2. I'll just leave it at that because what's it called?
The Book of Shadows.
Right.
Subtitle. Yeah.
But I think everyone would just call it Blair Witch 2. Don't you think?
Yeah, or BW2.
BW2.
I'll do a lot of that too.
Right. And that's coming out this Friday, and obviously it's not shot like the first one. We're just talking about this. It's not done in documentary style. This is, and you can pick it up from here, guys. You explain it without giving too much away, obviously.
It's really, really different than the first one. It's shot like a film, not like a documentary, but it's made by a documentarian. And we all play fans of the first movie, the core fan group that made the first movie with the success that it was.
Now, do we... So, but we recognize the first movie as being real.
No. It's a movie.
It's a movie.
Yeah.
It's a movie, and depending on the character, the movie has different meanings. It either confirms a legend or witchcraft for any particular character, or, like in the case of my character, it's just a bunch of bullpucky.
Oh, skeptic.
Yeah.
We know you get it good and you get it hard.
Oh, yeah.
In the gory.
Totally.
It's not lethal injection that does you in. It's or something rusty through the sternum.
It doesn't vaporize.
No, it's always great, yeah.
No comment on the vaporization.
They have to fall hundreds of stories and then land on something sharp. Not enough that you just land on something hard. It's got to be sharp. Oh, yeah. You'll pay for that skepticism, my friend.
Yeah.
That's why I'd like to announce to the world I believe in witches, sorcery, the devil, and all that good stuff.
Just not God. I see.
I believe in the bad guys. Boogeymen, trolls, the whole nine yards. Drew's wife, everybody.
You'd rather spend time in hell than getting struck by lightning.
Right. Right. Although lightning is a kind of a merciful, quick way to go.
Yeah.
And the good news is if you do live... You have superhuman powers. I mean, only
grow to be 8 stories tall.
You know, it's funny in movies and cartoons. Someone gets hit by lightning, and then when they come to, they find out they can read people's minds or something like that, or some nuclear waste gets spilled on them, and they have superhuman strength. Real life, one side becomes paralyzed, and their speech becomes slurred, and they have a burn mark from the cross they're wearing around their neck,
and
they become incontinent. There you go. Other than that, it's exactly the same. That's a good superhero character, Drew. You're bitten by a lizard, or you're struck by lightning, or exposed to nuclear radiation, and you become incontinent man. You just sit around and crap on yourself every day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Horrifying.
That's the next movie. Let's get back to the Blair Witch. So, Erica, what is your character?
My character's a witch, basically a Wiccan, which is a white witch. I worship nature and... people's bodies, and sensuality and religion are sort of united for me.
All right, so, yeah. So
I just know how Adam feels about Wiccans and his perception.
Yeah, you are not fat. You cannot be a Wiccan unless you're fat. They're all fat.
That's not true.
Wiccan is a white witch, and a Mo-Wiccan is a black witch. I don't know if you know how that went. But, no, they're all fat.
Why don't you
they're
like Wiccans?
They're all fat. They're all big. They're big, heavy-set women who can't date, and they got abused when they were younger, and they spin off in their own sort of bizarre fantasy. Because, listen, skinny chicks don't have to cook up love potions. If you really think about it, they got to wear garlic around their necks. They're not hit on by a bunch of Guidos driving IROCs. They don't need to entice men. Now, it's always husky chicks. Always. I've checked it out. I've done some research. Are you Wiccan?
Maybe voluptuous. No.
Big bowling balls. Big round women. Did you hang out with those women?
I met a couple of real life Wiccans, and I have to say they were quite voluptuous. But not fat.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, first off, they're always eating. They're stirring that huge kettle. There's a big goulash in there. And they're always wearing those, they're wearing those black muumuus. I mean, come on. Yes, you hung out with Wiccan women. They're huge, right? You were the skinniest one there, right?
Well, they didn't like me, the Wiccans
like
I met at
skinny,
first.
Skinny bitch, they called you.
Yeah, they didn't know how I was going to represent them because, you know, they were worried about that I was going to Hollywoodize Wiccans a little bit.
And you were Bogart in that 6-foot sub they brought for the Wiccan meeting.
No, Erica looks great in a muumuu, though. I have to admit that.
They're all big, though, right?
I didn't meet any small ones.
There you go. Oh, another one of Adam's bizarre stereotypes magically comes true,
but
everybody.
I'm sure there are small Wiccans.
No, they're not.
Petite Wiccans.
Yeah.
All right. Betty?
Hello.
You're 19?
Yes.
What's up?
Hi.
Hey.
Okay.
Oh, turn your radio down.
Oh, you goofball. I'm going to put you on hold. Okay, she can't even hear that part. We'll get back to her. She'll turn the radio down. Tanya?
Yeah.
You're 31?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, I just want to say hi to Dr. Drew and Adam.
I'm Tanya.
Hello.
Huh?
What's going on?
What's up, Screwy?
Okay, my question is, I have this problem where when I have an overactive bladder, like if I have a coughing attack,
if
I sneeze.
Ooh.
You pee?
Yeah.
Have you had children?
No.
You've never been pregnant?
Never, no.
Are you on a medication?
Antidepressant.
Which one?
Celexa.
Wizola.
What's that?
No.
Nothing.
Celexin, yes.
Celexa shouldn't do that, but this is called stress urinary incontinence, and it very common as you get older. You're a little young to be getting this, and it can be a complication of pregnancy.
Probably makes the person who told the joke feel pretty good about themselves, though, wouldn't you say?
Yourself? That's nice.
Yeah, it'd be nice.
No, you're looking for that all the time.
No. Okay, but I have another question.
If someone cracks a smile around here, I consider it a small victory.
But Tanya, it's stress urinary incontinence. There are medication to help with this. It's not so much an overactive bladder, though. Sometimes that can be part of this, too.
I mean, but this is, like, really... I mean, sometimes if I have a coughing attack, it's really a lot that I
I understand.
All right, but as a woman, I know this may sound a little grotesque, but couldn't you wedge something, sponge or something up in there?
People have to wear pads all the time sometimes.
Yeah, but as a guy, you're screwed, right?
I don't wear
in a way.
Sponge.
Yeah, it's hard to catch.
Wait a minute. As a guy...
You wear a diaper.
No, but what about a balloon?
You can wear a...
Well, how about just a gutter?
Well, you can wear a condom, a catheter condom.
It just goes down your leg?
Condom catheter.
Well, where does that end up?
You strap it to your leg.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Jeez. Imagine if you're a detective and you kept your gun on one side and your condom catheter
your
on the other.
Your bag on the other.
You got confused somehow and reached for your bag. Yeah. All right. So, wait a minute. Drew, what about... Okay. I see. Fine. All right. But she can put a pad up there, right?
Yeah,
what kind of pad?
I don't know. It's a Kotex pad.
Oh, really? Just one of those awards?
It's not that. It's that she has a condition. It needs to be evaluated. I don't think it's what's called a neurogenic bladder. But, look, there are other things that can be associated with this, like problems with the spine, sort of compression of the spinal cord, these kinds of things. So it does need evaluation because she's younger than she should be to have this problem. If she were 70, I would say, hey, this is a medicine we can try, but this is something we're going to have to live with.
All right.
And there's all kinds of procedures now being done to help manage this problem.
Yeah.
All right. So
they inject collagen into the urethra. They have local nerve blocks into the sacral area.
Does this have anything to do with when I was younger, I had, I was hospitalized for bladder infections.
Why were you getting bladder infections when you were younger?
Well, I mean, I don't know.
Are you diabetic?
No.
Sexual abuse?
Yes.
Oh, well.
No.
Yeah. This could have something to do with that.
Okay.
Who did this to you?
My grandfather.
Great.
Nice.
All right. Is he dead?
No.
Oh, that's too bad. You think he'll die soon? That'd be nice. Hey, can you dance on his grave when he dies?
No.
Maybe take a leak on it? Those sort of final how do you do?
Yeah, did you bring my book in?
I didn't bring it in to show him. I told him Drew gave me a book. I told my therapist I was going to read, because I don't read.
It's a good idea.
It's a good idea, right?
Unable to read?
Both. No, I don't read very well, but I don't like it. You know, but I realize it's something important. One should read. That's the way I think. And one should learn to write and things like that.
Your therapist agreed.
My therapist agreed. So
it's a good thing you should learn to write when you're writing a TV show and a movie. You gotta start thinking about learning to write. It's nice, Adam.
Yeah. Well, had I known.
Start with the reading.
Listen, I thought I was going to do construction my whole life. I didn't know Ivan Reitman was going to come calling. But I got a partner who does all that.
And he must be delighted.
Yeah. See, we have a deal. He thinks all the ideas, and then he writes them down. That's our agreement. It's a great partnership. But I'm not a good reader or writer, so I told my shrink I'd read.
So what are you gonna start out with?
Well, Drew. Now listen. Before you drop that kind of attitude, I already read The Phantom Tollbooth. So how dare you?
Wow.
Okay. Yeah.
Good job.
So I got that under my belt.
Yeah.
And I think I read like a autobiography on Rod Carew or something when I was somewhere like in the 7th or 8th grade too. I think. Or maybe it was like Isaiah Robinson was a linebacker for the Rams
or
something.
Start with the little engine that could or something like that.
I may have started. I think I had like Yertle the Turtle read to me when I was in the 8th grade. Jennifer?
Wait a minute. So what about the
I got to read Drew's biography on, who was it on?
Oh, boy.
Well, I haven't gotten into it yet.
Evidently not.
I'm scared I won't be able to put it down.
Theodore Roosevelt.
I told Drew to bring me a biography because, you know, I figure if I'm going to read, I might as well learn something.
You wrote a biography on Theodore Roosevelt?
Yeah, I love biographies.
No, he read it.
Oh, he read it.
Yeah,
I thought he wrote it.
No.
He has a few biographies, and I wanted that one.
A biography.
I wanted one with the most pictures. This one has no pictures and 800
pages.
That's
pretty intense.
Yeah. Jennifer?
Yes?
You're 19.
Yeah.
What's up?
I wanted to ask Dr. Drew a question.
Okay.
I am going through radiation therapy for brain cancer, and I haven't had my period yet. And I wanted to know if it's normal for radiation therapy to mess with your hormones.
Absolutely. So you never had your period?
No. I've had my period. I just haven't had my period within a month.
And you started the radiation a month ago?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely, that can cause that. You need to talk to your doctor about that to make sure they know that's happening. Sometimes they have to supplement, yeah.
Why?
Well, your pituitary is in your brain.
Well,
no doubt.
Light
of fire here.
Hey, Jennifer?
Yeah?
Is it working out? You going to be all right?
Yeah, I'm going to be fine.
Really?
Yeah.
Jeez, that's good.
What kind of tumor is it you have?
I have a grade 2 astrocytoma.
Okay. All right. We're just hanging in there, and you still going to school and all?
Oh, yeah, for massage therapy.
Massage therapy, interesting.
Yeah.
Really? 19.
Uh-huh.
You're going to junior college? You don't need your brain over there. You can probably graduate without your brain.
How did your astrocytoma present?
I had a seizure.
Okay.
About a year ago.
Okay. And they didn't recognize it until recently, or they just been watching?
No, I had brain surgery in April, and that's when they came up with the cancer diagnosis.
I see.
Okay. All right.
Great.
All right,
good luck,
stay
Jennifer.
With it, Jennifer.
Okay, thanks.
Take
Bye-bye.
Care of yourself.
All right.
Oh, boy. All right. You guys want to kill yourselves with me? I'm going to go hang myself in the bathroom. You guys want to go? Can I wait till the next break?
Yeah.
All right, we'll do the next break. We have some of the kids from Blair Witch 2 here tonight. We will get back, take some more calls, talk a little more about the movie, and do all that after this.
Loveline. 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Drew over there, phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Carrot Top and the Insane Clown Posse are coming in this week, but not on the same night. Erica Leerhsen and Stephen Barker Turner are both here tonight from the Blair Witch Project 2, which is called the Book of Shadows. Yeah. But you'll know what Blair Witch do.
And the Book of Shadows, by the way, it's a witch's diary.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
And that's as probably like a recipe on there for like fudge nut brownies. And it's actually a recipe book, isn't it?
I think you're just generalizing them about Wiccans. There are a lot of different kinds of Wiccans.
Well, there certainly are. There's fat and fatter. they run the range from fat to obese in the Wiccan family. And listen, all you screwball Wiccans, this go eat some dirt. Don't call this show. I don't want to hear from you. And listen, first off, God does not recognize Wicca as a religion. He'll throw you in the same pen as he throws in the Santerians and all the other troublemaking religions. Believe you me. Just whatever your dad did to you, just get over it and get on with life. Lose a little weight and join the rest of society. That's what I want to say to all Wiccans.
Erica, I think you have to
defend the Wicca religion.
I know. Poor girls.
Well, wait, let's talk to them.
I've met them. A lot of them who are not at all fat in any way.
Well, yeah. Sure. But they're bulking up.
I think we should hear from some.
Let's talk to some so you can prove your point.
Any Wiccans out there should call in.
How long have I said the Wiccans were fat?
We've talked to a lot of Wiccans.
Do you ask them if they're fat?
I always do. And then Erica hung out with a brood?
A gaggle.
A gaggle.
Flamboyance.
of Wocks. They should really change their name to Wacca, because that's something you can fry food in. All right, you hung out with them, and magically, they're big gals.
No, the ones that I hung out with were a little bit on the voluptuous side, but I have met ones that are not, that are younger, you know, more teenage.
Right, still, like stuff. I said, bulking up. Okay, listen, good-looking chicks don't have time for that stuff. They're too busy dating, going to the prom, and enjoying life. They don't get together and
You might be surprised.
Spells. No.
Yeah.
No. Only in TV. TV and movies, the witches are good looking. Real life? No. Nope. Craig?
Hey, yeah. Adam, Drew.
You're 19. What's up?
It's an honor to talk to you guys. I appreciate you taking my call.
Good to talk to you.
I have this little problem. My sister, she's 13, and sometimes I find myself attracted to her school friends.
It's perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Are you? Why don't I believe him?
I don't know. Because why would he be talking about it in such a cavalier manner?
Yeah.
Craig, we don't really believe you.
Don't believe me.
Now we really don't believe you.
Yeah. No.
Guys who lie, it's always the same thing.
Outrage.
Hey, don't believe me. Like,
How dare you?
Well, listen, let's just say Craig is telling the truth, or to anybody. And here's the deal. Here's why I don't mind talking about anything on this show, depending. I don't care if the call's bogus or not, because somewhere within the sound of my
voice, is doing this
somebody's thing. Listening who's 19 and turned on to his sister's 13-year-old friends.
I was. My
when you were 19?
Yeah.
But you weren't contemplating doing anything about it, were you?
Well,
call the police.
Define contemplation.
Not unless you call excessive masturbation.
That's the point.
Exactly.
You have a younger sister?
Yeah.
And she has some cute little friends?
Yeah. Yeah, when I was in high school, you know, towards the end of high school, it was, it fed some fantasies, sure.
Yeah, but having fantasy, and that's normal, but to be thinking about, I want to do this.
Oh, like jumping on somebody.
Yeah, to actually
be planning sort of, the, you know, to be building a treehouse from which you can jump on top of them, that's a problem.
Yes. Well, I'd write that down.
Don't give Adam any ideas.
I'll just put P for pounds. Right, or pants. Hey, here's the deal. Yes, everyone, think about whatever you want, just don't do it. And that goes for everything.
Yes.
That's ambitious. That's life ambitions. That's families.
That's the definition of adulthood.
That's right. That's right. Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 20.
Yes, I am.
Yes. My motto is figure out what you want to do in life and then nap.
you missed a step. You missed a step.
Oh, wait, what did I say? Masturbate. And then nap. Right, Drew. Right. I forgot. Sorry.
Man,
write that down.
Keys to life. You almost screwed it up.
Screwed up. Oh, man. Imagine if I have kids, how misdirected they're going to be about masturbating before their nap. Got to bring that up. That's right. Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 20. What's up?
I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
I've never had an orgasm, and I realize that that's completely normal, but I'm wondering, like, what I can do to make it happen, because I've tried many different things with my boyfriend, but it still just doesn't happen.
How about by yourself?
Yeah, once, but didn't do anything for me.
Isn't that interesting?
What do you mean? You had one, but it didn't do anything?
She tried to do something. No, tried to masturbate one time, and it was so sort of flat, so nothing. She never went back.
Right.
Yeah. How old are you?
20.
I'm 20.
Do you have any tips, Erica?
That's, I don't know. I just sort of find out, maybe think more about what turns you on. Have you ever been turned on in this situation?
Well, yeah.
So
what is it? What does it for you?
Well, a lot of different things, but it's just like me and my boyfriend have tried different stuff, but there's nothing does it. Like, there's points where I'll just either get bored or just be like, you know, this is not working and it starts to hurt, so I'm like, stop.
Maybe like more of a fantasy that might turn you on as opposed to reality?
Well, we've tried that and we've tried everything. It's not a fantasy. It's just like he wants it to happen because he feels bad that, you know, he's like getting his and I'm not getting
mine. Are you in love with your boyfriend?
Yes, I am.
Is he going down on you?
Yeah.
He is?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's not doing it either, huh?
Uh-uh. I know it's normal. You know, a lot of people don't have them.
It's common. Sometimes at 20. Why don't you figure yourself out while you're alone a little bit?
I just don't want to.
All right, well, screw you then. You get an orgasm.
Who cares?
Wait.
Someone should be.
Listen, she doesn't want to do anything.
Yeah, but
this
goes right to the core of the difference between male and female biology. I mean, male, you have to roll up a newspaper, get him, you know, start smacking him to get him to stop. And there are females for which it just doesn't make sense. It just doesn't work. And there's no sort of language to help women understand how, and you're starting to use that language, which is think about a place, think about a feeling, think about some experiential material that helps turn you become sexual. And for women, if they can sort of get into that place in their limbic system, in their emotional centers of the brain, the sexual piece will function.
I think they're too worried about what turns the guy on, and they need to think more about what turns them on.
That's right, unless he has a radio show. Now, listen, I agree. We got to take a break.
Yeah.
She needs to work things out for herself and then get back with her girlfriend, all right?
Boyfriend,
sorry. More fantasy there. We'll take ourselves a little break. We'll be back.
Loveline will be right back, so get your problems ready.
It's Loveline on the station. You're listening. Oh, man. That sucked. I was unprepared. I wasn't focusing.
You were faked out.
Yeah. Sometimes, I don't know what there is. What do you think there is? 3 seconds in there? Two and a half? Three?
Two.
One, two. Two and a half. Maybe two and a half beats in there? What do you think, Anderson? Two?
But you try to take it right up to the edge of the music.
I try to do good radio where I squeeze in a little something in that beat, and I'd say it works out about one every 25, 30 times.
I want to do it one time.
You think you could do it?
Sure.
All right, here we go, Drew.
You got to talk during it, too, though, of course.
All right, keep it going, buddy. Yeah, there it is. Come on.
Hey, it's Loveline. I'm Drew. He's Adam.
No.
You want a break?
Too long a beat. That's what I'm saying. It's
you
stuck.
Want the beat there.
No, that was a beat and a quarter. Beat and an eighth. How dare you? That was way too long. That was very rocky. Very rocky. Very Bush League, Drew. How long you been on the radio now? 17, 18 years? Maybe by year 20.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, I'll keep practicing.
I swear, that's longer than 2 seconds. Now, let's devote an entire show to that maybe next week. Erica Leerhsen and Stephen Barker-Turner are both here tonight. They are in Blair Witch 2. The movie comes out this Friday. Erica plays a young Wiccan, yes?
Yes.
Who's in this movie, and a young, thin Wiccan. That's how you know it's a movie. If you ever get scared, you just close your eyes and you think, thin Wiccan. and I'm skinny. I'm not fat. And by the way, I like my suggestion of changing Wiccan to Walken. Or Wicca to Waka. That's what I want. There you go. Something you can fry.
A group of walks.
Something you can fry something in. Sage?
Yeah.
You're 15?
Hi.
You claim to be a thin Wiccan?
Well, I'm 5'5", and I weigh 110 pounds.
Uh-oh. They're going to toss you right out of that. They're going to ask for the broom and the pointy hat back if you want.
No,
you
let, stereotype.
Let the word get out. What? So, are you Wiccan?
Yeah.
All right. What happened to you?
Nothing.
Come on, seriously.
So, if I'm Wiccan, it must be something happened to me.
Where's Daddy?
My dad is in his house.
He's what?
He's in his house.
In his house.
In his house. All right. What kind of guy was he when you were growing up?
Normal guy.
Mm-hmm.
Why did your parents break up?
I'm not really sure. My mom never really talked about it.
Hmm. How old were you when they broke up?
Like 11.
Yeah.
And you never noticed anything going on?
No.
Do you love your dad?
Yeah.
He didn't smoke pot or drink?
No.
He was a warlock.
She? Did she eat your mom?
No,
alcohol?
No. Okay, like male witches will get really pissed off. I'm sorry if I said that.
That's all right.
If you call them a warlock, because the word warlock means, like, truth twister, and you'll just have to call them a male witch, you know?
Means what twister?
Truth twister.
Huh. I'd rather be called a... Hold on a second. Wouldn't you rather be called a warlock than a male witch?
Yeah, it's like male nurse.
Yeah. Yeah. I picture a guy in a candy striper outfit. That's horrible. All right, so, say, seriously, what's up with you? You don't have any friends?
Yeah, I have friends. I'm a very, like, very rather shy. I don't believe I'm actually talking on this. I'm really scared.
Okay.
No, I'm not weird at all.
You're afraid of what?
Hmm?
What are you afraid of?
No, it's just so weird. I mean, like, I feel so sorry for those people who stay on for, like, hours and they never get through. I got on for, like, about 5 minutes.
Yeah, that's good. Well, that's because you're a thin Wiccan.
And I don't really appreciate you, like, making this whole stereotype about, like, an entire religion of people you don't
know. No, it's a ridiculous religion.
It's not a ridiculous religion. See, now you're getting me all screwed.
All right. Well, yeah, sure it is. But listen, no more ridiculous in Judaism or any or Christianity or the other nonsense religions.
Okay,
that make no sense at all.
Back B.C., right?
Hmm? What's that?
The beginning of the time.
What right? did?
So it's not, like, ridiculous.
Well, I know, but all religion goes back. It's where people's brains weren't developed. They saw a volcano erupt, and they had to make that stuff a god in it so they could figure it out. They didn't know about molten centers and magma and all that kind of stuff. It's really like a primitive thing, religion, if you think about it. I mean, it's sort of...
Yeah, it's like theater.
It's like theater, yeah. To me, it's a ridiculous premise, but if it works for you, I'm fine with that. It's just, I'm just saying that Sage needs to put a little weight on if she wants. Listen, all I'm saying is certain religions have certain things that go along with that religion. Like the Hare Krishnas, they got the haircut and the gown, right?
Right.
The Jews, they got the beard, right? The rabbis wear the beard. The Wiccans, they got the spare tire around their belly. It's almost a costume of the religion. You have to stay with that. Joe?
Hey.
You're 25. What's up?
Hey, every time I get a BJ from my wife, the pre-cum makes her gag and throw up. I was wondering.
Nice.
Heard of anything?
Oh, man. I wish I could be there for that. That's great.
That turns me on.
And then what's she do? Does she keep going?
She just quits and it kind of ruins it.
She really throws up? She throws up like totally?
Yeah, she'll run to the bathroom and just throw it out.
That's love, by the way.
Wow. You heard anything like maybe her taking a swig of Jolt Cola or something?
How about wearing a condom?
No.
I can't get off of wearing a condom.
Yeah, but you can't get off with her vomiting on your dork either, can you? I love calling a penis a dork. That sounds funny. Well, Joe, you're not getting off anyway. She's vomiting, right?
Well, she does it the other way most of the time, but I'm right now just lucky to get a BJ once or twice a year, so I was wondering if anything you heard of anything.
What's the other way?
She'll use a nostril.
Oh, okay.
is that what you're talking about, Joe?
No, Joe. I don't know of anything, maybe ejaculating before, you know, a little while before.
There's nothing, you want to know how to stop the leakage or stop the throwage of uppage?
Either, whichever works.
You can make it taste better somehow? Or
no.
Well, we do hear stories.
Eat lots of cookies.
I hear a jar of Miracle Whip. Or was it Dijonais? I can't remember.
There's the pineapple myth and the pineapple juice and this juice.
Couldn't hurt. Try it. And why not?
Pineapple yogurt myths. These are all myths, but you can try them, certainly.
Joe? Yeah, you can try that.
Don't they have, like, flavored things you can use, too? Not that I know about.
You mean like a condom or gel or
something like that?
And actually, if you if you started using a condom, couldn't you eventually get sensitized to?
Yeah,
I mean, if you potentially,
maybe she's not into it either.
Yeah.
Hey, Joe.
Yeah.
How much leaking do you do?
I'm pretty good leaker there.
Yeah, you're all class, buddy. I don't know. Is there any way? Yeah, it's just bad news. I don't know. You got to get a divorce, Joe.
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know what to do. I don't leak. Oh, thank God I don't leak. I know I'm not a religious man, but I really, if I was, I would thank my maker about not leaking. Some guys leak, and I don't think there's a thing they can do about it.
That's right, no.
What about some kind of Kegel exercise or something?
That's an interesting idea. I haven't thought about that, but I don't think it would do much. But
Okay, you can try.
It's something to try.
There's a brilliant idea that won't work?
Then make a try. Again, there's not much that will work, but that's worth a try.
Well, what muscle do you need to strengthen? What is it?
See, it's not so much a muscle. As a system, a tube system.
Actually, I read in a sex book once that that to practice that to exercise that muscle is when you urinate,
right? To interrupt it.
Yeah,
right.
So you do 10 that we had discussed. So you do 10 contractions to a count of 10, and then 10 rapid contractions, and do like
five sets of that. Using a number 2 pencil or through a muscle?
Just do concentration. Do like 5 sets a day, and it takes a lot of effort. Christ.
Oh, I never knew about this stuff.
Kegel exercises?
Yeah. Yeah. While thinking about your Wiccan girlfriend.
Right. Well, Drew.
Yeah.
Guys who do leak are...
Give me the magazine.
No.
Yeah, give me the magazine.
All right. This is the plumbing... Here's my question. Guys who leak, is it that they're too excited or is it their plumbing isn't
it's plumbing.
Good?
It's a plumbing thing.
Okay. Drew has opened up the anatomy book. He's going to turn to the penis page, right, Drew? Yes. Oh, please, with the vagina page. You know how that upsets me. Okay.
This is where the leak is just coming through here. This is where everything's all stored up in here.
That is a squid that got pulled up onto a tuna boat, Drew. I have no idea what that is. What is that?
Seminal vesicles.
Where's the nut sack? Is that down here?
Down here.
Right down here.
Yeah.
And the semen then... What?
The semen gets produced by all this up here.
Oh, really?
It gets stored and waiting for a release in there.
What's this for?
This is the sperm.
I see.
Sperm getting mixed into all this.
Mixed in, comes in. So what muscle do you have to strengthen?
Again, it's not a muscle so much, because you see the muscles are way up in here.
All right, so it's lost. It's a lost cause.
Well,
Boris, okay, do the Kegel thing.
What are you exercising when you do the Kegel exercise?
You're exercising the floor of the pelvis, which is across here.
Boris.
Hello.
You're 14. What's up?
Yeah, I have this... all right, first I want to say, Drew and Adam, you guys are really cool.
Thanks.
Love your show.
Thank you.
Adam, I agree with you, like, everything. And I watch Family Guy all the time.
Oh, good. I really enjoy that show. Yeah, I just did another voiceover for that show. I really love that show.
Were you deaf?
Well, I was... Yes, I am deaf in that... in an upcoming episode.
Oh, okay.
The last death was...
Was that Norm MacDonald?
Was Norm MacDonald.
Right.
And Norm MacDonald was too high and his gambling problem was too big, so he couldn't come... At least that's what his publicist told me. He could not come in and do... one reason or another, Norm decided not to be deaf again. So I then took over as the Grim Reaper and did a couple of episodes as the Grim Reaper on the Family Guy.
I can't wait to see it.
Actually, they gave it to me last time I was there last week to take home and watch. I really enjoyed it, so I think you will, too. Anyway.
Right, that'll be fun, then.
Yes, it was a funny show.
All right, to my problem now. I have this this kind of, I don't know if it's like, it's not as much as a rash as it's kind of like, it's on the underside of my penis,
mm-hmm.
like right where it's like kind of, I don't know, connected to the testicle,
mm-hmm.
testicles, mm-hmm. and it's like this, it just looks, it's like red, and if you like run your finger over it, like the texture is kind of smooth, and it's almost like it's kind of oiled or something. It's like it's all red.
Do you have anything anywhere else, like in your scalp or face?
No. I mean, I have like acne, but it's not like that.
What's oiled?
Do you have seborrheic? It's like
there's almost like a thin layer of like some kind of liquid or something. It's not like really noticeable, but
how long has it been there?
What?
How long has this been there?
Well, it's kind of, it goes away. I don't know if it's like if I masturbate too much or like cause that or what.
Do you have dandruff? This sounds silly, but you sure?
Yeah.
Nothing like that? Because it sounds like seborrhea a little bit, which is sort of oily scales.
Oh, the heartbreak of seborrhea and psoriasis. Yeah. I remember that from the Cells in Blue commercial in 1974 or something. The heartbreak of psoriasis. I remember that. Yeah. And then,
I have eczema bad on my hands, but when I was a kid, Erica, you're going to know something personal about me. But it started on my penis.
Sure, it can be.
Seven or eight.
But eczema, look, show us your eczema. It looks a little dry.
From humping stuffed animals, right? Is that where it starts? Humping Winnie the Pooh and Tigger too?
Show Adam. You got.
Let's see that. Drew, don't touch him. He's like a leper.
See, this is the
eczema.
And see how dry and scaly that is. But seborrhea is oilier.
Would you turn your
hand? It's charming.
Get your hand turned a little more. Is your arm going to break off? There we go.
Here's a good spot right here.
That's disgusting.
That's a good one right there.
Yes, you're a mess.
And that's not oily.
You belong behind the camera, young man. Your career's over. You'll never work without gloves. You could play the Invisible Man, but that's it. That's the extent of your range.
I'm going to do the remake of The Singing Detective.
You could not play the hand from the Addams Family. All right, Drew? Yes.
So
what were you saying?
So seborrhea is a little more of the oily stuff. And or infection. There's recurrent strep and staphs that can cause a little bit of a
What should he do?
Try some Cortate over the counter, and if that doesn't clear it up, you got to see a dermatologist.
Rub that on your huevos?
Then the connection, the frenulum there, yeah.
Yeah.
That's where he has the problem.
Yeah, you got to get that Cortate over the counter, because that now has a tenth of 1% of cortisone in it. It's the maximum strength cortisone, now with a one-tenth of 1%. Fantastic. Boy, nothing instills confidence like seeing that big one-tenth of 1% cortisone on the cortisone cream that you're buying. True. Why can't we get some over-the-counter stuff that works?
The only thing that's ever worked for me is prescription stuff.
Right.
Cordate and all that.
Hands are tougher to penetrate.
How much does that stuff cost? You got to get in line, then you run out of
it. Well, if I have insurance, I don't know how much it really costs.
Have you ever tried to eat any of that stuff? I'm doing a survey because I kind of wish they just put that stuff over the counter. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
what's
sure.
the danger?
You go
into a pharmacy, you go into the thrifties to get the thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
On the shelves, you can buy tequila and sleeping pills right there.
Right.
As well as you probably buy like frozen corn dogs, which got to be worse for you than anything you rub on yourself. I mean, you can buy lighter fluid and Sterno. You make a bomb. You have charcoal briquettes. You can make a bomb from stuff that you find on the counter on the way to the prescription counter. And you could drink yourself to death and kill yourself. You take a big handful of Tylenol, wash that down with a fifth of Jack, die in your sleep. Right, Drew?
Right.
Your liver shut down, right. Kill you, right?
Right.
Why the prescription for the crap you rub on your hands? I just don't understand that. It doesn't make sense to me. It really sounds... Yeah, that's what it sounds like to me. And why aren't Gore and Bush talking about this? All they talk about is prescription drugs. Why not? Let's talk about the stuff that is prescription that doesn't need to be prescription, like crab shampoo. Crab shampoo, for Christ's sake. Why don't those pussies talk about that? And the toothpaste my dentist gave me. This has extra fluoride. This is prescription. Don't tell anyone I gave it to you. That's right. Because I'll kill myself with this. I get whole... You know what I'm like with fluoride, Drew? I'm a madman. I'm out of control with that fluoride. I get that and something that's like actually 1% hydrocortisone. I go on a rampage.
Right.
That's what I head
for.
Head for the border, man. Yeah. What the hell? Give us this stuff that works. It's the only stuff that worked, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Get in line and wait a week and pay through the nose for it. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
Why can't someone address this? Why isn't Gornbush, why don't they discuss this? Why not say, hey, here's stuff that's effective, we believe it's safe or no more dangerous than anything else that's out on the shelf. Let's start taking some of these things and making them,
Let's make a movie about that. Why don't we campaign?
A young guy who campaigned.
There, we could use your hands, finally.
Right. A young guy just trying to get some eczema cream.
Right.
Maybe it just doesn't keep, like it sort of goes bad, and so that's...
Well, milk goes bad, and if you drank it after long enough, I'm sure it would hurt you. Hot dogs go bad in your refrigerator. We don't eat those. There's plenty of examples of things that go bad.
They make a prescription.
I think if we got some campaign finance reforms, we'd be able to ask questions like, why is this not the case? But let's talk about the high-dose, the high-potency corticosteroid creams. If you put them on your face, they will discolor the skin. They will hypopigment it and bring blood vessels to the surface. It can be very disfiguring.
Right. And if you take sufficient amount,
you actually absorb so much, you can cause Cushing's syndrome. You can actually shut your adrenal glands down with that if you take a lot of it. So somebody needs to monitor it. But no one
monitors it anyway, really.
Yeah.
If you think about it. Think about all those drugs you give me, Drew, right out of the trunk of your car. You don't know what's going on over there. And listen, if I hear another goddamn commercial for some prescription thing where they then start listing the side effects, still with the chick kickboxing in the background, really living her life, causes projectile vomiting, greasy stool syndrome. It just keeps going and going and going and going. And I think as I'm sitting there eating my meal, hearing about senior euphoria and irritable bowel syndrome and all this kind of stuff, and I think to myself, why can't the doctor be responsible for telling the person this? Why do I have to hear it? Me, who does not even need this medication. You know what I mean, Drew? Why don't you talk to some of your attorney buddies about that?
Mm-hmm.
Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 16.
Yeah.
What's up?
I lost my virginity about 6 months ago, and I've had 13 sexual partners since, and I wanted to know if this was normal.
It's a little light for one of our callers. We'd like to see up around 20, 21.
Usually someone
On the other hand, you're just getting started, so
oftentimes
may have been a slow summer for
you. A young person who's had an unpleasant experience first time out, like a rape or something, will go out to try to master and regain some sense of power over these experiences.
Did that happen to you?
I was molested by my sister's boyfriend when I was 13.
That ain't it. It's got to be. No.
Yeah.
There you go, Melissa. There you go. Surprise, surprise. Drew, we're all individuals, aren't we?
Yeah.
Everyone's their own. There's no way to predict any kind of human behavior, is there? No, there's not. And all those Wiccans are thin, and we all know what's going on. So, Melissa.
Yeah.
All right. So now you're just doing a lot of acting out, right?
Yeah, you need to get some help with this. It means different things to different people, and it can be more serious if you have a history of addiction or if you are biologically prone to addiction, because it can set up an addictive process, too.
Right.
A way of trying to master feelings, a way of trying to regulate pain that you really will do anything to avoid. And sexualizing your feelings tends to regain some mastery over that initial trauma.
Melissa, you lost your virginity at 15 or 16?
16.
At 16. And you've had sex with then 13 more guys, and you're still 16 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I had that plan, too. I lost my virginity at 16 and vowed to have sex with 13 more women. I met that mark at age 33. Just exactly the same as you, except for what you were able to accomplish in 6 months took 16, 17 years for me. I was doing, I wasn't working as hard as I could have. I think I could have gotten it in under 15. The over-under was 19, so I'm
a depression came in there and held you back a little bit.
That's right. Yeah. That's
your libido
right.
dropped.
That's right. And this hairstyle wasn't always in fashion, which is another thing that slowed me down just a little bit, I believe, in the late 70s, early 80s.
So, Melissa, this is something that needs a little help, okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
And this was your sister's boyfriend?
Yeah.
How old were you?
I was 13.
And he was how old?
He was 32, I believe.
Fantastic. Oh, he's a wonderful individual. What's he do? Work around metal?
Construction.
Yeah. As all the dirtbags I used to work with. Well, hopefully an I-beam or something will come loose and crush him.
Yeah.
That'd be nice. And your sister, how old is she?
She's 22.
Mm. I see.
So she was 18 when he was 32.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Nice. And where's daddy?
My dad's at home.
No.
Really? Really? Is he a good guy?
Not really.
No.
All right, baby. You take care of yourself. Stop trying to solve your problems with the penis. Drew tried that all through college. No relief, was there, Drew? That penis didn't stop the pain. It was a temporary fix.
I didn't use other people's, though.
You used your own.
Yeah.
On yourself? I see. All right, we'll take ourselves a little break. When we come back, we'll talk to... who we got to talk to?
I want to get see what's...
Okay, we'll talk to... Oh, mystery caller after this.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
You're listening to Love Line on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
Bring that up. Hey, it's Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Erica Leerhsen and Stephen Barker Turner both here tonight. They're from Blair Witch 2. And Stephen says, anyone going to ask about the movement? I thought that was a good question.
Yeah.
See, this show doesn't run like, it's not Larry King. People call in and talk about their nuts. And they don't call in and talk about...
Well, our movie and nuts are curiously related. I won't tell you how.
If someone has any question about Blair Witch 2, which is coming out this Friday, please call in and ask it. And if you guys want to bring something up about it, something that we may not know, some interesting twist or wrinkle, like where did you guys film it? Canada?
No.
Outside of Baltimore.
Outside of
Maryland, yeah,
Baltimore,
where the original was filmed, right?
Right near the town, yeah.
Yeah, not in the town. We couldn't get into the town because the town of Burkittsville, where the original one is set in, was really pissed off because people were, you know, millions of people were swarming the hills trying to collect dirt and stones. And
Just like camping out. And that's what our movie's about. These kids who just go and, like, camp out there.
Yeah.
And did you have to film it there because it would... look the same as the first one? I mean, because it had to take place. I mean, why did you have to go back there?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a certain feel to being there. The landscape is, you know, especially people who are from Maryland and know that area, and you know, you have to sort of honor them.
And we did some kind of like town scenes, and we used real people from the area and stuff, so it had that authentic, weird kind of feel.
Yeah.
Small town, but in Maryland, very distinct.
Yeah, the Maryland woods are scary woods.
Yeah, the Maryland people are scary people.
They're funny. They're really funny. The people in our movie are hysterically funny.
Yeah.
Drew, we've been in Maryland, right? Or we just drive through it?
The University of Maryland.
Oh, yes. Wonderful. The Terrapins.
Terrapins.
The turtles.
Yeah.
Right?
I was sick vomiting, remember?
You owe me for that show, buddy.
Yeah, that's right.
Drew, what'd you have when we were over there? We did a little lecture in
we were coming out of Philadelphia.
That's right.
Yeah, and I was, you and Stuart.
Me and the driver. We had this great driver. We had to drive. We drove from Philadelphia. Where were we? We did a lecture at the University of Pennsylvania, and then we drove to University of Maryland, right?
Right.
What, it was about a 3.5-hour car ride?
I was... eternity.
Drew was nauseated in the back of the town car,
moaning
like he really like
motion
he had,
sickness. No, I just got some virus. It was just awful.
He got stuck with something in his side, and I had the
spear.
We had this driver who was great. This guy was about it's about 5'2".
5'2",
About 5'2". What'd he go?
280. Big 320?
280 a second. That's,
but
then
he
that's
lost
in the morning.
Like 300
that's
pounds.
Right out of the sauna.
Right, remember?
Yeah, he lost a bunch of weight, but he's still about 300, about 5'2", and he liked talking food. And Drew was in the back, and it was great. You know, Drew rarely loses his composure, but this guy was like, well, you know, the reason they call it the Philly cheesesteak is because it was originated it wasn't in Philadelphia, it was in Pennsylvania. And there's a lot of imposters out there. First off, you need the Velveeta, lots of Velveeta, and hot. hot and creamy, molten Velveeta. You dump it all over that greasy steak, and you got the onion. And then some guys go with the provolone. Not for me. You know, and he's going, me and him are,
somehow you
me
got
and him are waxing on
I
about food.
I just remember
food.
Losing it when you got into bacon. Somehow bacon came up.
We're talking about food for about 150 miles or something. Cruising back, he's holding the sign. He's like, oh, yeah. And I'm like, what is the difference between Canadian bacon and, I don't know, European bacon? And what you call North American bacon. And that'd be Canadian bacon. And what do they call regular strip bacon? Is that strip bacon? Is all bacon smoke? I don't like the bacon. Not when you put it in the microwave. I fry it up.
It's all about the grease.
And Drew, at a certain point, he leans forward and he goes, shut up! Like he'd been bite. I guess he thought that we're going to stop talking about food probably for like the last 100 miles or so. But we never stopped talking about food.
And I was like delirious. I barely had
enough
energy
strength.
To sit up.
All he could do was lean forward and yell at us both to shut up.
All right.
And then he fell back in the seat. And then there was like 20 minutes of silence from me because we had nothing else to talk about. It was like, the Eagles look tough this year. Yeah. And we start drifting back. Yeah, stadium's good, yeah. You got pretzels there. No, forget it. Like, you know, you're consciously trying not to talk about something.
Like,
you
don't just think about it.
Yeah. So now elephant. Here's your choice. Either talk about food or nothing. Now, like, we couldn't think of anything else to talk about.
What you did next?
What did I do next? We pulled over somewhere.
For food.
Oh, yeah, we got hungry.
You stopped for food.
Yeah, we got to pull over. We got to get something to eat. We pulled over some rest
AM,
stop, too.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Ooh, you know what we did? What? All right, then we're moving on.
What?
We pulled over to a place near Sea Cane.
Oh, yeah.
Which is a place I almost grew up in or was when I was a little kid.
Well, these are wonderful stories.
You know when you're born, Huell Hauser, it's bad. Chris?
Chris?
Call it
who? Yeah.
Yeah, how's it going?
You're 28.
He was asleep.
What's up?
Boy, I tell you what, man, I can't believe I'm talking to you guys. I'm a longtime listener.
Fantastic.
Nice.
First time I got through.
All right, Chris, what's going on?
Man, where do I start? Actually, I got a bunch of questions and a bunch of theories and a bunch of things to talk about. But
all right.
No, come on. I want to hear him.
You know what I like most about this driver? The guy was 5'3 and 300 pounds.
Tony, was that his name?
Yeah, Tony. He kept saying he doesn't pry. I don't pry. It's none of my business. What you do is your business. I don't ask questions. I say live and let live. You ever finger bang your wife? You ever do that? No? Hey, whatever. That's fine, because I don't know, and I don't care.
Remember the John Gotti story?
He just keep going. Yeah, he's talking about John Gotti, and hey, what he does is what he does, and what I do is what I do. I'm good friends with John Gotti. I had him kill somebody, but I don't talk about it. He just kept talking about how he doesn't talk about stuff, and he kept talking about stuff. Chris?
Yeah.
All right, so go ahead.
Okay, the question is, before anal sex, is it fine to douche? Is there anything that can happen down there? Is there any problems, any repercussions that could come out of douching before you have anal sex?
You're talking about douching in her vagina?
No, douching in her rectum.
At that point, I believe you'd call that an enema.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, but what if you enema with douche?
Enema with douche. It seems a little...
Might get you on a technicality there.
A little irritating, I suspect.
Let's call the whole thing off.
But I think...
You know what I'm saying is, I mean, you're not going to disrupt the ecosystem down there, are you? Or?
No, go ahead and enema. Enema sounds like a good thing before introducing anything else into that vicinity.
If there's an ecosystem down there...
There is indeed.
That might be a problem.
Yeah, it's the indigenous people that live down there that you really... The aboriginal tribes. You don't want to bring your... You can wipe them out with the common cold.
Boy, you guys understand? Are old tonight.
All right, so Chris, no, feel free to douche.
Or she can... Enema.
Enema, okay. whatever she wants to call it.
No, I only say
ecosystem. No,
Chris, that's the way Adam describes.
That's right. No, we're with you, Chris.
There's a lot of flora and fauna. That's right. All right, there, Chris. Fantastic.
I thought you'd want to stay with Chris. He's a pretty colorful guy.
Well, he kept scaring me because he was like Floyd the Barber with that. You know, he'd go sign for it and then he'd go, bah, this time. Then he kind of like coached his time. Well, this is a douche. It scared me. I'm going to turn my headphones down.
It's like your compressor.
Yeah, it just fires up while you're standing around. Let's see if you had one more thing. Chris?
Yeah.
What's up, Chris? What else?
I'm sorry. I'm just...
That's all right, buddy.
I'm
excited.
Tonight, I was drinking with a buddy, and I introduced him to your guys' radio show.
Okay.
Like I said, I've been a long-time listener.
Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Sacramento, California.
All right.
Beautiful country, aren't they?
And I gotta tell you, too, I work for the United States Postal Service. I work swing shift. I work from 2:30 to 11.
Huh.
And I'll tell you what, man, at 10 o'clock every night, we listen to 98 Rock down here, 98.5.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys are, we're mechanics.
Oh, really? You work on the cars with the wheel on the wrong side?
We work on the old Jeeps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like the guys who buy those at auction.
Actually, they don't sell them no more.
They don't?
No, I guess a couple people had problems with them rolling over.
Yeah.
So the government, they restricted the sale of those anymore.
That's too bad.
Yeah, now we just have them crushed. Yeah.
Ooh.
That's good. That's our tax dollar hard at work. We can get $1,000 for these. Instead, we'll pay $1,000 and have them crushed. Fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, Chris.
Hey, you guys have...
What else got a straight six in them?
Some of them, yes.
Yeah, it's a lot of engine for that vehicle.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, could get five of the four.
The new ones are actually made by Ford. And
nice.
They have a V6 in them. They're called CRVs, Carrier Route Vehicles.
Great.
Yeah, and they got big.
All right, it's enough. Listen. I like the guys who walk the beat. I don't need them driving around over there.
And by the way, does anybody have any question for the cast, the Blair Witch?
Oh, yeah. We've got to work those kids in, too. You guys hanging in?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. This is...
You learn about mail?
This is fun.
Jay?
Yes.
You're 19?
Yeah.
What's up?
Well, first, I just wanted to say that I really respect what you guys do, and, you know, I'm glad to see that somebody cares enough to touch people's lives. The way you guys do.
Not many people take the time to call Wiccans fat. And I do, because I care.
You have to make the time to do
that.
That's
right.
What's up, Jay?
Well, my girlfriend was raped actually twice. Once when she was like 15, and once, and just recently, I believe.
We would suspect that you're even missing a third time when she was like 4.
Same clown?
Yeah.
Well, actually, one was a longtime friend when she was 14, and then the one just recently was the father of her son. And it just upsets me because, like, the reason why I have a problem dealing with just recently...
Hold on, put the tabby on. Let's get to the bottom of this. What is that?
That's the cat.
Is your cat?
Yeah, he's very vocal.
No kidding. Wow. It's like he thinks he's making a commercial or something.
But,
he's on the other line.
The reason why I think I have a problem dealing with it is because, I mean, she didn't do anything about it. You'd think after the first time, the second time.
Jay, she was sexually abused much earlier, I guarantee it. This is that profile.
Wait. Now, what happened most recently with the father of her child?
He raped her. What she had told me is that, you know, somehow she ended up naked and she was scared and he started to have sex with her and then he stopped.
Somehow. It could happen. No, I know. You you go to pick up your kid and you're just wearing your underpants and wind kicks up.
And fly off. Yeah,
certainly. I mean, she said that they were trying to work things out at the time and then after
that. Well, what about you? Where were you?
Well, we hadn't started dating until 4 months after that.
I see. And why is she telling you all this stuff?
Well, because I'm one of the only guys that she, quote, says she trusts.
Uh-oh.
You're the perfect guy.
Yeah. No, you're in trouble, Jay.
Well, no, this is a little bit different. This is perfect.
Really?
This is idealizing that
Jay's perfect.
For the fall.
Jay?
Yes.
How old is she?
She's 20. She's going to be 21 in May.
All right. Here's the deal. And I don't want to discourage anybody from being with somebody who needs help. But be prepared.
This is a tough road to hoe here, Jay.
She's gonna be a lot of trouble for you. I mean, you may not be experienced enough or worldly enough to be able to handle this. Things are gonna keep cropping up with her.
Has she been in psychiatric care before?
No, I mean, I've tried to convince her to do some sort of something, you know, but she hasn't. And
she's never been.
No, she hasn't. I've tried to just be a listening ear for her, just to try to, you know, because I don't know much about it, but just at least she's talking about it.
No, all right.
Hey, Jay?
Yeah.
I want you to make me a promise.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think of the rest of the question. I just thought something would jump into my head if I got started down that road. Apparently nothing. Anything? No. Here's my promise that you need to make. You hang in and be as good as you can be. You, A, don't get her pregnant. And B, if she really starts getting weird and provoking you or really getting on you or whatever, you got to get out. Okay?
Okay. What do you classify as weird? Like,
she may try to sort of get you to abuse her at some point,
or accuse or provoke you in some way.
Right.
Or accuse you of things you didn't do or perceive things that were completely different, distorted.
And all relationships have their problems. Yeah. I've been hanging for a while. Don't get her pregnant and don't try to cure her. If she can play along and do her therapy and take care of herself, great. But you don't want to be her nanny.
Would playing into that strangeness be like weird sexual fetishes, like talking dirty and stuff?
No.
But there's going to be a certain amount of she's going to want to be hit a little bit sexually and that kind of stuff, which is fine. I mean, a little rough trade's nice, but she's going to do some stuff. I'm saying keep your eyes open,
and
Jay.
And expect that there's a history of childhood sexual abuse here. That history is there somewhere.
She's told me she has. Dreams almost of something happening.
Right. Well, something happened.
All right, Jay.
She doesn't know.
All right. I'm telling you something happened.
Okay.
Jay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And get used to being with the cat, because this may be what happens. All right?
All right. Thanks.
All right.
Bye.
What's a cat's name, Jay?
Just Felix. For fun.
Felix.
Yeah.
Amazing. All right. Hold on a second. I mean, hold on forever. It's going to be the name of my book. All right, we're going to take ourselves a little break. Who's got some questions about the Blair Witch project, too? We'll field some of those after this.
Oh, yeah! Love Line. We'll be right back. Call on the 1-800-LOVE-191.
Radio 100.7
The Buzz. KQBZ. Seattle. Hey, Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. She is Dr. Drew over there. I call you she. An Italian, a sports car, boat, or something like that.
Maybe I'd be more effective if I changed sexes.
It couldn't hurt.
Couldn't hurt.
It's the old Jewish enema joke. Goes. Insane Clown Posse will be in here later this week.
I was just thinking, God, with Carrot Top, that would have been sort of a genius pairing, wouldn't it?
And they both those folks scare me for different reasons. But either way, I'll be frightened at least twice this week. And speaking of frightened, you know what's coming out? The Blair Witch 2 is coming out coming up this Friday. Erica and Steven are both here from the new movie. And Erica, by the way, was summa cum laude. Do you know that, Drew? Is that right?
At
Boston University. Cool. That's a real school.
How did you know that?
You know, I got a vibe off of you. I got, I knew you were smart when you walked in this room.
Yeah. So summa, you did a thesis.
Well, I was an acting major. So
you did a thesis?
So, production? Thesis production. But it's more like I didn't direct it. I was just in it.
Of
A Tale of Two Cities.
No.
Yeah.
Dickens.
Good, Adam.
What? Dude. I'm a genius, I tell you.
You don't have the control.
How'd that work? That worked, that Tale of Two Cities?
Yeah, it worked, you know.
That's you got Zuma, Adam. Come on.
That's a real funny movie book there. Funny, right? Comedy?
Yeah, it's comedy.
All right. All right, you ready to roll here? Jeff?
Yeah.
You're 14?
15.
Been on hold for a while. What's up?
Yeah.
It's ironic because Jeff, we've never had this before, but it actually says 14 twice.
Yeah. Almost three times.
It says it twice when it never does on any of the other calls except for the one that's wrong.
14.
All right.
Maybe it did,
Jeff. I've only been 15 for like a month, so.
All right, buddy. What's up?
Yeah, it's for the Blair Witch people. Did anything weird or spooky happen on the set when you were filming?
Three crew members died.
No, that's not true.
They ate too many donuts and exploded. The chair broke they were sitting on after eating way too many donuts at the craft service and died. I know those union guys work. All right, what? Anything good?
Well, there are a lot of weird people hanging out in the woods who actually lived in the woods in shacks.
Really?
Oh, really?
Yeah, I was, like, going around exploring, like, in these crazy shacks.
And, by yourself?
Yeah.
No.
So I was bored sometimes on set, so I'd just, like, go off. And I heard
PAs
all these...
PAs would have to wander off and find her.
Yeah. I heard all these legends about, you know, people who were, like, living out there. It's a really weird place. I don't know.
Did you come across people?
I didn't come across an actual person. I just kind of looked around his house.
Drew was jogging in a riverbed in Pasadena yesterday and found a fecal matter that was shaped into a pinch pot. Talk about frightening.
As God is my witness.
Yeah, you want to talk about a horror? That's a Los Angeles horror story. There, we don't need goblins. We have deranged homeless people crapping in riverbeds. That's a true horror. All right. So now
people would come out of the woods. Yeah. Actually, when we were filming like certain scenes, they would start coming out at night.
Just like where Ted Kaczynski lived, right?
And start walking up to us and just.
But that's the idea. Kind of living situation.
It was freaky, but I didn't actually meet anyone. So.
While
we were filming a hospital scene, we had a sign crash on one of our cast members.
Scary hospital.
An emergency room sign, sort of. But that was basically just a sort of set dresser's accident more than...
It fell right
more
under
than
her
a witch.
Face,
ooh. But yeah.
She all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Didn't die a thousand deaths?
No.
Too bad. Eric? Yes, that's you?
Hey.
Hey, you're 16. Are you stoned?
No.
All right. What do you want?
I like to masturbate in class.
I see. Which class? Driver's ed?
No, science.
Science?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hey, could I make a shout-out real quick?
Uh-huh.
Nope.
Oh, no. All right. Let's talk to Amber.
Hi.
Amber, you're 20. What's going on?
I'm not 20. I'm 15.
All righty.
Yeah, I have no gag reflexes.
That's good. What's wrong? Hey, Amber?
Yeah?
So, how do you know you have no gag reflexes?
Because I was like...
Drew, what are you
sorry.
Doing? Stop monkeying. Amber? Jesus Christ.
Whenever, like, I deep throat guys, I don't gag.
I see. Yeah. I was that way in high school, too. I could take so much Johnson. It was unbelievable. They called me the penis, king of all penises, they called me
in
high school. I'd take the whole football, soccer, line them up. I'll take you all. I said, that was back then. Now it's like, oh, boy. You know how it is.
After just
older.
The football team, you got problems.
Yeah. You know, you can no longer, you can't take that schlong anymore. But that's more old age and. You lose everything when you're older. Amber?
Yeah.
I'm just saying enjoy it while you can.
Yeah, but are there any, like, health risks that can go with it?
Of what?
We get AIDS.
Wait, the risk of what?
Like, I don't know, just choking.
Wait, I understand what
Well,
yeah, Adam, you went in such a weird direction with this.
The penis is attached to something, right?
Are you saying that you just don't gag? Is that the deal?
I don't gag at
and
all.
And that's the question. Can having a... absent or
all right, no,
suppressed gag reflex hurt you. Yes, you can choke. Gag reflex is there to prevent you from choking.
Yeah, but all you got to do is sit up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
To avoid choking, you mean?
Yeah, just, you know, lean up and, you know,
chew with your chin
swivel
down.
One of the captain's chairs from the vans back toward the highway and you'll be fine. Hey, listen, Amber, what do you want? What happened to you? What's going on with you? You didn't call because of that. Why are you blowing everybody? Who abused you?
No reason.
What's up?
Nothing.
Who did what to you? Where's your daddy?
Asleep.
Mm. Where, in prison?
No, in his bedroom.
Who, you get sexually abused?
No.
Someone's an alcoholic?
No.
Huh?
Not really.
What do you mean, not really?
They occasionally drink.
Physical abuse?
No.
You ever raped?
No.
When did you lose your virginity?
14.
How old is the guy? 45?
No, he was 16.
All right. No stepbrothers?
I have a stepsister, but that's it.
Did she do anything weird to you?
No.
Wait, is this dad you're talking about, your biological dad?
Yeah.
Yeah. What about stepdad?
I don't have any stepdads.
All right. Okay, why
stepmom?
Yes. Huh? Why are you going down on everybody?
Whoa, you have a stepmom?
Yeah.
Where's your mom?
My mom lives... I haven't seen her for like 13 years.
Ah, mm-hmm. Now we're getting warm. What's up with her?
She's on drugs.
There we go. Aha! Well, okay, I was working the dad side.
Yeah.
What's your mom's drug of choice?
Heroin.
I'm not sure.
But it's a bad one, right?
Yeah.
All right, so now you're screwed up, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you're not going to solve it by blowing guys. God knows, I tried to drown my sorrows in semen for many years. And although rewarding, you know, to some degree. Yeah, I got a quick fix of semen, sure. But over
gratifying
the long run,
in the moment.
That's right. That's it.
The point is, Amber, that the individual you needed to help you develop the systems in your brain to be able to regulate your own feelings was not there. She was either on drugs or actually physically absent. And that now leaves you trying to find other ways of feeling better, feeling good about yourself, and you're going down the wrong road. Right?
No pun intended.
You really are. And find friends, activities that are gratifying for you, give you a higher sense of worth and esteem. Spend time with people that care about you. Do not go down the road you're going down.
And maybe you're getting a sword swallowing or something. Somewhere you make a living in a circus or something. I'm saying parlay that. You take that. You take the lemons, you make lemonade.
Yeah.
All right, we'll take a break. Easy now, baby. All right?
Yeah.
All right.
Thanks.
We'll be right back.
Show known as LoveLine. What's your host, Adam Carolla, and Dr. Drew? 94.7 NRK. Oh, boy. I'll tell you, we do our best work when these mics are cold, Drew.
Every night.
We did, we have to talk for some time about doing the LoveLine during the commercial show, right? We're really good at the truth. All right, everybody. Go out and see the Blair Witch 2. When Blair Witch Project 2, when it does come out, which is coming out this Friday, right?
Yep, and October 27th.
Big, fat, wide release, right?
Yeah.
And, wait, when's Halloween? That's right before Halloween, right?
Right before mm-hmm. Halloween.
Perfect. Couldn't be better. All right. I'm going to thank Erica and Steven for both coming in here and being sports tonight. And again, Blair Witch 2 coming out this Friday. Thanks a lot, guys.
Thank you.
So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo. Well, he doinked me a couple of places.
This has been LoveLine. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for LoveLine is Ann Wilkins Engel. LoveLine is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.